give him praise this morning. Amen. Somebody shout hallelujah. First Corinthians 1:18. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. You can see that on the news. They make fun of it. They jest of it. Almost like that they're writing off Christianity as really a non-essential. It's foolishness to the perishing, but listen. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Amen. Praise God for that verse. Let's give God, let's give God's word praise. Amen. The series is about having Christ lead us. The first place of our day has got to be Him leading us to the cross. In time of worship, time of praise, time of devotion, just a time. This may be one of my top three songs of all time to sing and to just lift. Guys, let us let God know this morning how much we need Him. Sing with us, will you, as we endeavor to worship Him with us.
Spill for my rest.
God. Praise God.
Let's pray. Father, you are the good shepherd. You have led us in new places. You have taken many of us through the valley of the shadow of death. Father, our hearts are grateful that you're the good shepherd, that you saved us, that you loved us, and that you continue to lead us. God, we thank you for who you are and that your love was poured out for us. We thank you for making a way for us to come back to you. Lord, our hearts think about many things when we come into your presence. We think about loved ones who are not feeling well. We think about stress and strife that we see in the world and maybe in our workplace and perhaps even in our own homes. God, you are the God of peace, and we know that's what you would prefer us to experience. And someday in heaven, we will. But Lord, until that time, continue to be the good shepherd. Continue to lead us. Continue to make us lie down in green pastures beside the brook. Lord, we love you and we thank you for all that you're doing. Help us, Lord, to let our light shine brightly in our community. Help us, Lord, to be the people of the book. Yes. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. This year's theme from Pastor Bruce, you've heard before, is deeper roots, greater fruits. And so one of the initiatives that in the Christian education area that we decided to launch was a Bible reading plan for the year. In case you weren't aware of that, you can find that on our website. You can, if you have already decided to commit to that, we would like to know about it. If you haven't decided to commit to it and you're still thinking about it, on our Facebook page, there is an event about the Bible reading plan, which you can join, and we will send you words of encouragement from time to time on that, because we believe that this is one way to help have deeper roots. Another way that you can have deeper roots is in a small group, and on February the 12th in the afternoon, there'll be more information coming in your bulletins in the next couple weeks. But on February 12th, probably in the later part of the afternoon, there will be a small group fair where we're relaunching some small groups. I see many of you who have come to me and said, hey, I'm interested in being a part of a small group. What can we do about that? So this is your opportunity to come be a part of that. If you're just not sure, hey, I'm not sure what the small group thing is. Do I want to be a part of it? I encourage you still to come that day, find out, get some more information. That's, again, February 12th in the afternoon. That's the week after this big football game that's taking place. I'm not sure if you know about that or not, but it's the week after that. So we'll see you then. Thanks.
A while back, we had a membership class, and we brought some members before the church, but a couple were out of town, and they didn't get a chance to do that. But today, we're going to bring them into membership. Larry and Brenda Wright, if they would come at this time. For those of you, how many of you remember Jim and Jean Wynn? Okay, they were good friends and connected to them, and that's how I met them. I had a brother-in-law named Larry, but I like this one. we've talked about that time and time again. But come on up. Hey, guys, these guys have been coming for a while. They love Jesus, and they want Jesus to bless their home and their family. And, guys, I want you to let them know how much you appreciate them coming into membership. Amen. I appreciate this guy, these guys so much. And as you think of them, pray for them, will you please? We all have family concerns and issues, and they would be right alongside of us. Pray for their family and pray that Jesus would bless them all. Justin, if you'd come.
Good morning. A couple things. First of all, read your bulletin. Second of all, if you haven't picked up your giving statements, they are at the Welcome Center still. So as you're leaving today, be sure to pick those up. And as our ushers make their way forward, I've got a really cool God story to share with you that happened last night. Angela and I got to go up to Winter Jam with a couple good friends last night. It's a Christian concert that was at the Schottenstein Center and had a lot of fun, a lot of great bands. And towards the end, I needed to stretch my legs. So I went out in the hallway, and I actually did two laps around the arena. I was checking out the booths and vendors and food, and I did not succumb to the temptation. I just looked. But I'm walking, and all of a sudden, this 10 to 12-year-old boy just appears right beside me and starts walking beside me. And if you know me, I'm not what you call kid-friendly. So at first I'm like, oh, great. And he starts talking to me. Hi. Hey. How you doing? I'm good. You having a good time? Yep. What's your name? Justin. So about that time I started realizing, okay, God's doing something here. I have no idea what. Like most of the time I don't. But I'm like, all right, God. You're trying to tell me something, so I'm cool with this. I'm just going to go with it. So he tells me his name. He says, you like Jesus? Yep. Sure do. Where do you go to church? I'm like, dude. Heritage Memorial Church is where I go. Oh, really? I go to Trinity up in Marysville. I'm like, oh, that's great. And I said, I'm actually a pastor at my church. Oh, cool. And he like shook my hand. He's like, all right, see you later. Like, once he knew that I was a Christian, he's done. He's like, phew. And what I realized, he was trying to share his faith with what he thought was maybe someone who didn't know Jesus. And I'm thinking, you know what? God spoke to me. Like, is he trying to tell me to go witness to someone and I'm not doing it? I'm being hesitant, or I'm scared, or I'm worried about what they'll do or say. And if that little 10-year-old, 12-year-old boy can come up to a complete stranger with a beard who doesn't exactly put off the kids come talk to me vibe, he walked up fearless, he was confident in his Lord, then if he can do it, then what's our excuse, you know? So if God's speaking to you to witness to somebody, just be obedient, all right? Let's pray. Father, thank you. Oh, thank you. All right, let's pray again. Father, thank you. I just want to stop and thank you for that little boy, Lord, and ask that you continue to bless him. Lord, bless his family, bless his church, and Lord, keep using him to speak truth into people's lives and to bring glory to you with anyone he comes into contact with. Lord, I'm so thankful that you use that moment to speak your truth into my life. And Lord, I pray that he has many, many more opportunities to do just that in the lives of others. Lord, I pray your Holy Spirit would be present in this place. Lord, change our hearts. And Lord, we ask that you would receive this offering, bless it, and use it for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If I rise, let me rise on you. Not on all of my successes, my esteem or my pursuits. If I lose, let me lose my life. 'Cause if I belong to Jesus, the flesh is crucified. For me to live is Christ, For me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ. To die is gain. If I grow, let me grow in you. Wilt the seeds of wants and more, ripping pride out by the roots. And if I'm still, let me hear you speak. Not the tone of my transgressions, but the song of the redeemed. For me,
and it will be given. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened. Prayer is the way we talk to God. Prayer is openness. Prayer is freedom. Prayer is for the brokenhearted. Prayer is for the sick. Prayer is for the hungry. Prayer is for the children. Prayer is for the old. Prayer is for the joyful. Prayer is free. Prayer is God's gift to us. Accept it, use it, and believe it. Prayer works.
Jesus and the church is the hope of the world.
Amen.
And prayer is the ammunition of that hope. There was a lady who was at work, and she received a phone call that her daughter was very sick and had a fever, and the babysitter was really concerned, so she asked to get off work and go home, and so she stopped at the pharmacy to try to find some medicine that would help her daughter. And while she was in, she had locked her keys in her car. So she went outside, and she's very stressed and anxious about the condition of her daughter and the fever, and so she just begins to pray, God, I don't need this right now. Anybody ever prayed this? Lord, I don't need this right now. And she prayed the prayer, Lord, I don't need this right now. Just, God, please help me. Send somebody, please, my way. And she somehow finds an old rusty coat hanger. And how many of you know what I'm talking about when I say an old coat hanger? But she still held it in her hands, almost like, yeah, thanks, Lord. Now, what am I going to do with this? I don't know. Then all of a sudden she just says, God, please. And then one of those motorcyclists, very dirty and mean looking, tattooed everywhere. And he gets off his motorcycle and says, ma'am, do you need some help? She said, really, God? She said, I'm going with it. So she said, yes, sir, my daughter's very, very sick, and I really, really need to get in my car, lock my keys in my car. And he said, give me that hand, coat hanger. So he had her keys in her hand in less than 60 seconds. And she hugged him and said, thank you, sir, I appreciate it. You're such a nice man. He said, no, ma'am, I'm not a nice man. You see, I just got out of prison, and I was there for auto theft. She gets a big look on her face and smiles. She comes, praise God, God sent a professional. This series is about following the lead of Christ.
And we have talked to you and shared with you sermons about following Him to the river where we consecrate ourselves. And then we follow Him into the wilderness where we learn how to fight temptation that comes our way. Today, we're going to talk about prayer. Because Christ gave us lessons on prayer. And today, we find that time where Jesus is ministering. In fact, Luke 11 is the passage that you need to turn to. And as you're turning to, just note that in Luke 11, Christ is praying and He comes back and He has the disciples ask Him this question. I have double-checked, confirmed it this morning so that I would make sure I'm telling you the truth. This passage of Scripture in Luke 11 is the only place where you will find the 12 disciples asking God to teach them something. Now, I don't know about you, but if I had seen Peter walk on water, I'm just brave enough to say, Jesus, can you teach me how to do that? Or you remember the funeral where the young fella, the widow, and she'd already lost her husband. Now she lost her only child, her son. And it's going past and Jesus stops and raises the boy from the dead. How many of you would have the guts to say, hey, Jesus, can you teach me how to do that? Or the whole 38 years next to the pool, the guy has himself been waiting for the stirring of the water, and Jesus walks up and heals the guy after 38 years. And all of a sudden, I think I'd ask, hey, Jesus, a lot of hospitals around. Can you teach me how to do that? The only place you find the disciples asking, I want you to show me and teach me how to do that. It was about prayer. And why do I ask the question? I mean, think about it. It may have been because Jesus had said several things like, ask and it shall be given to you. Or if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done. Anybody like to have that? Or about whoever says to this mountain, be moved and does not doubt, it will be done. Or if you ask the Father for anything in my name, He'll give it to you. I mean, we got stuff that Christ is talking about, where He's talking about, God, if you can make that happen in my life, teach me how to do that. So there was something about His prayer life, something about either how He did it, or how He did it, or the power in which He did it, or the brokenness in which His passion was. We can't know that until we get to heaven. But I do know this, they were so impressed by it that they even ask Him here in a second, you'll read it with me, and they'll say, teach us how to pray. Oh, by the way, John did that with his disciples too. Jesus, we got to have that. See, Luke 11 shows it this way. Now it came to pass as He was praying in a certain place, when He ceased, one of the disciples said to Him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught His disciples. So He said to them, when you pray, say, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us day by day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Now, I already know, I think, is a past class that's doing the Lord's Prayer. I know that we already have a class that's doing the Lord's Prayer. And my job this morning, ladies and gentlemen, is not to dissect this prayer. That can be done in that wonderful study. If you want to catch up on all that, catch their class and get there or study it yourself. What I want to do today is I want to talk about a simplistic look at the prayer. But more importantly, I want to preach on three words that I just read. A certain place. Jesus had a certain place. Now, you could question me and say, Pastor, really, all that's referring to is that day He happened to go to a certain place. I challenge that because I take you to Luke 15 that says this. Luke 5, 16. So He Himself often withdrew into the wilderness and prayed. Let me also read the Message. This is Eugene Peterson on the same verse. As often as possible, Jesus withdrew to out-of-the-way places for prayer. One of the most important lessons He would teach us. Listen, Guys, listen. I'm about to preach to you what I feel is convicting me most. See, I have my routine. I have my devotions, and sometimes I wait to get to the office. But sometimes my devotions are on the back porch where I have a recliner. And I just kind of plop myself like I'm watching some NFL game. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm saying I had this moment where I'm reclined in the presence of God. And I was convicted by it. And the Lord spoke to me basically saying, I want you to kneel. So I do. I feel that what I'm preaching today is not only what I need to hear, but what all of us need to hear. That prayer should be more than something you do from home to work. It should be something that you do not during commercials. Our prayer lives should be something so important to us that it's something above what the Pharisees did. Something, because they saw something. They had been raised by the temple, and they had seen the Pharisees, and the Pharisees often prayed like this. They, with outstretched arms, looking up, they would say, and if you check out Luke 18, you'll find a passage where one of them looks to God in this parable, and he says, basically, this is my assessment, God, aren't you glad I'm on your side? I'm not like that publican over there in the corner who can't even look up. God, I'm looking up and I'm just so proud of you and you're so proud of me. And if you read on to that story, the publican was beating his chest saying, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And then Jesus turns and says, which one of them went home justified? You see, what I want to talk about is maybe it was his passion, maybe it was how he was free in his prayer, or that somehow it was the position or the posture in which he prayed, or how humble of a version that he had, or maybe how specific or broken Christ's heart was for the prayer time. Either way, the 12 disciples were so impressed by it that they had to say, God, Christ, teach us to pray. Now, there were four things, and again, I'm not dissecting the prayer. I want to do a simplistic outline of four things that are necessities when we pray. The first is who He is. To kind of illustrate what I want to say in this point is, any military people in the house that have been through basic training? Anybody here remember basic training? Ronnie. Basic training, what's the first thing we learn in basic training? Respect your training instructor. I was in a double stack barracks in San Antonio, Texas, and we didn't have an air conditioned barracks. It was July and August, and it was hot, and this happened to be one of those black flag days where we weren't even allowed out of the barracks, and our instructor, which by the way, we had to respect him, he was a former offensive lineman for the Texas Longhorns. So he is big. He was huge. Tech Sergeant Brown. And the reason why he'd been in 20 years and still had only gotten a tech sergeant, here's why. Because he'd been in so many bar fights beating up on guys that he'd get docked in his pay grade and he'd have to work back up again. This guy could clean your clock and everybody knew it. All he had to do was look at you and you knew. Yes, sir. But we happened to have Mason in our group. Mason was a kid from the inner city who was not intimidated by anybody. And we were in the barracks, and all of a sudden it was that day where Tech Sergeant Brown was bringing all of us in and giving us an assessment, and that's when he called Mason's name. Mason! He's downstairs. And here's his response. What? Everybody upstairs leans down the hallway to see this rated R movie that's about ready to play out. R for really stupid. He leans across Mason! What? That 325-pound frame of a man, there, I'm guessing, I might be a little short on that one. That building was so old, every step he took, we heard creaking of the rafters. And he said, Mason, you get... Within 6 hours, he was gone. Now, there's something called setback. There's a bunch of other things. I don't know what happened to him. All I know was Mason had forgotten who he was talking to. Amen. How many of you can say, I'm not asking anybody to say to humiliate yourself or guilt yourself, but how many of you can truly say that there have been times you've prayed and in the fashion in which you prayed, you may have forgotten who you're talking to? Disrespectful or just trivial prayers. And here we have Jesus teaching us, our Father, who art in heaven, holy be your name, or perfect you are. He's teaching his disciples as he's teaching us. We cannot forget who we're talking to. Before we ever offer petitions, we've got to remember to get the person right. His kingdom is the only kingdom that keeps Satan from completely annihilating mankind. His kingdom is the only eternal kingdom that can salvage and save a world. He, God, is the only respectable person to pray to. So when we pray, number one, remember who you're talking to and make sure, stop. Leonard Ravenhill said it best. Your attitude prior to prayer is as important as the actual content of what you're about ready to pray. When you go into prayer, God was telling me, get off the recliner. You're talking to me. Secondly, it's okay to ask what you need. Give us this day our daily bread. Trust always comes before triumph. This request, by the way, the word bread in the New Testament wasn't always, it wasn't just necessarily about a loaf of something that we slice or we put bologna on. Doesn't that sound good? Amen. Moving on. That squirrel liked bologna. Bread meant, it was a symbol for the daily needs. It's okay to pray for your daily needs. This prayer is meant to cover all of life. It's a prayer that God, listen, God wants to hear you. Ask Him. God, my marriage, thank you for us. God, my child, God, my job, God, my uncle, God, my family member who just found out that they're not well. God, we're short on food this week. God, He wants to hear you ask, give me this day, God, the needs that I need to have for my family. Praise God for that. You're allowed to ask those things. And don't forget, don't settle for something that merely you can do. Settle for what God... I know I've told you this story before, but I can't get over the true story of the guy that went on a cruise and he assumed that the food cost something, so he took cheese and crackers. So he had cheese and crackers for three meals a day for 4 or 5 days. Till finally he had enough and he said, I don't have a lot of money, but can I please get a little bit of food from your buffet? And the guy said, what's wrong with you? The buffet's free. So many people settle for our best. God may have a whole lot more than your best. So what we need, we're allowed to pray for and remember who He is and what we need, but who we are. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. Guys, listen to this. Humility and sincerity are the fuel for answered prayer. I know what the Bible says, come boldly before the throne. But that word boldly has nothing contextually connected to arrogance and pride. Come boldly in humility and sincerity, God. I know who I am. The Bible says from Paul, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Jesus says, there's none good, no, not one. If you're going to kneel in the presence of God, remember that He's a holy God who saves you. He's a holy God who cleanses you. He's a God who makes your soul ready. He's someone who knows, you should know, that I'm down here and He's up there. Remember that when the Bible tells us to work out our salvation with fear and trembling, just remember this. When it comes to who we are, every one of us should take to our certain place the curse and the cross. In other words, we should go into our prayer time in a certain place, remembering where we've been saved from. And that all of us are destined for hell without Christ. But that's where the cross comes in. You got to remind yourself, I have grace is unmerited favor. I don't deserve it. I was cursed. I was lost. I had no chance. I had no hope. But He had the cross, what makes it possible for me to have eternal life, have joy, have happiness, have contentment, have Christ. Remember who we are, and last, what can be. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Faith is what pleases God. And here's what we can do. Let me just kind of do really fast. The fact is, when we look at Matthew and it closes off with His kingdom and His glory and His power, this whole passage is talking about, number one, that we have a real enemy. A real enemy who wants to rob us of our salvation and rob us of our souls. And he is determined. He has a file in his filing cabinet to take you out. I said that last week. So here's the deal. We need help every day. I'm thank you for that loud amen. We need Him every day. God, please. Don't lead me into temptation. In other words, he would not, Jesus gave us this prayer. He would not have put that in there if it weren't possible. God, lead me not into temptation. And guess what? He is powerful enough to keep you from falling into temptation. But secondly, I like that Matthew 6 version at the end, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Guys, the good news is, someday this race will be over. Praying for the future means, God, I'm not giving up. I'm not quitting. I'm going all the way through. God, I pray to you every day because I want to get to heaven. I want to take as many people with me. I want my family to come. I want my family's boyfriends and girlfriends to come. I want my church to come. I want the people that I meet on the street every day. I want the people that Greg and Mel meet every day to go. I want the jail ministry where those guys talk to those people they go to. I want everybody to go. And guess what? I'm going to keep on keeping on, God, because I'm going to see someday your face. Amen. We got to believe. In other words, a part of praying for the future is praying for future faith. God, I'm going to face some stuff in the future that I have no clue that's coming. But I know this, you can give me a future faith to overcome. There was a mother who had 5 kids who was very, very poor, and she was, every morning, they had nothing, and the little work that she had was barely enough to buy ramen noodles. And so every morning she'd go out on her front porch and she would say it out loud, and she did not care who heard. The neighbors heard it, her kids heard it, everybody heard it. She'd just pray in church, pray out loud this prayer, God, I can't do it without you. God, I need to feed my kids. I need you to provide. So I'm trusting you, Lord, that you'll do it in Jesus' name. Amen. Did it every morning. Till one day her atheist neighbor had had enough. And he said, I'm going to show her. So she went out and she prayed that prayer. Oh God, I need your provision. He went and bought 2 bags of groceries. Come back, put it on the front porch. And then he ran behind the bush to see just exactly what she was going to say. She came out, praise God, you have provided. He jumped out and said, no, he did not. I provided those groceries. She said, praise God, and the devil paid for it. We got believe that God is good enough that the devil will have to pay for our lives. So what I have simply today are, real fast, I have seven suggestions. Seven suggestions on how to thrive in the certain place. Now, I want to make sure you get the understanding. Every Christian needs a prayer place where it's just you and Him. Can I get any Christians in the house that know what I'm talking about to say amen? Amen. You need that certain place. So how do you do it? Number one, you sanctify your prayer life. You sanctify it. The word, the Greek word for sanctify, means to set apart. In other words, your prayer life is not mixed in with the NFL game. Your prayer life has nothing to do with the Buckeyes. Your prayer life has nothing to do with fitting it somehow in your schedule. No, you work your schedule around something that you will always do. You need to sanctify it. Set it apart. In other words, guys, some of you need, look at me, some of you need to get serious now. And I'm not saying you have to, by the way, you don't have to pray 2 hours to somehow be the hero of the day. I'm not saying you shouldn't. Go for it. What I'm saying is He wants all of you while He's got you. And I've watched some of the greatest saints I've known who would sanctify their prayer life. Have you ever met somebody, they were so good at praying, you've caught yourself saying, teach me to pray? I think of those people. But sanctify it. Second, shut the door behind you. Withdraw. Get away from everything that distracts you. Thirdly, focus your body. Now, again, I kind of already hit this with me. God convicted me on reclining as I pray. And so all of a sudden it had made such sense, even though I felt like my heart was right, my sincerity was right, but I felt like I wasn't honoring my God with my posture. But I'll also tell you that the greatest prayer times that I had in college were 5 o'clock in the morning when I was jogging. That's back when I jogged. 5 o'clock in the morning, I'd get out of the house and I would run. And I lived in Stoutsville, Ohio. And I could run down these farm roads. And they were all straight. No curves. They were all straight. And I would run like a mile or two. And then I would stop where it's still dark up, you know, in the sky. And the moon would often be right out in full effect. And then I'd go from jogging to just walking, and I would pour my heart out. I can't tell you how many days I wept as I walked. But it was the right posture. You know what I'm trying to get at? I'm not saying it's not merely how you contort your body. I'm saying how you make the moment His. Posture. Where you somehow get yourself, like for instance, maybe for you, remember the war room? I mean, maybe it's a closet. And your posture is, remember how that mom would sit on the floor and she would tape those things up on the wall and she would just, that's the posture I'm talking about. It's not necessarily how your legs are, it's how you feel. You feel that you're giving Him the most honor. So do that. Again, sanctify it and shut the door behind you and let your body focus while you do this. And fourthly, now, I'll be honest with you, if I were to tell you of the one question that I've had more often, outside of counseling and needs, like when somebody come in and say, I got marital problems or I got this problem with my kid or whatever, whenever they're just coming in for spiritual growth, it almost always connects itself to this question. I don't really know how to pray. If you're there, listen to this next point. Pray the Bible. How do you learn how to pray? The vocabulary of prayer is found in the Bible. I had a professor who taught me, in fact, the best way, I pulled out a handful of scriptures where I can show you what it means. Let me stop here and say this. This is not a squirrel, but it matters. Some of us read our Bible, pray. Read our Bible, pray. Try sometime praying while you read your Bible. In other words, when you come across a passage like found in Exodus 33 where it says, show me your glory. As you're reading that and you're in a posture and you're to pray and all of a sudden you come across, show me your glory. God, I want that. Show me your glory, Lord. Or another passage, turn my eyes from worthless things. Oh God, you know how I've got a problem with materialism. God, help turn my eyes from worthless things. Psalm 86, show me a sign of your goodness, God. Oh God, make that, Lord, make that happen to me today. Or let no sin rule over me. Psalm 119, God, keep that one sin that keeps hitting me, that temptation that keeps coming. Oh God, keep that sin from me. You see what I'm getting at? It's good to read. Pray while you read. Or last one, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. God, that's so true. He is so good. Nothing, nothing compares to you. Pray the Bible. Because sometimes, well, I've already prayed for my wife and my kids and my boss and that jerk of a neighbor I've gotten. And then you're done in like 30 seconds. John Maxwell said, he went to Seoul, Korea to go up on the prayer mountain. You know, they had that prayer mountain. And he said, he got on a bus to ride up. He said, the people were praying the entire ride up. He said, so I felt like, well, I need to pray. He said, but this is kind of like the warm-up prayer before you get to the mountain. He said, those people prayed the entire time. He said, 30 minutes, I was done. So I'm making stuff up. Not really. What he's saying is, boy, we Americans, sometimes we don't get it. Sometimes, if we run out of things to pray for, first of all, pray for the church. Hey, pray for your pastoral staff. I'm about ready to tell you something that I was going to hold until the end. When I started working on this sermon 2 weeks ago, since that time, there have been major attacks on high visibility people at our church. 5 families that I've prayed for and held a burden for over this last week. The devil is not happy with me talking to you about prayer. So as we talk about this, if you want to learn how to get your prayer life better, then man, get your Bible open and read a few phrases and think about how can I pray that for me? Get personal with God. That means fervent, expecting change. As some of you need to learn, if you haven't learned yet, there is a type of wrestling in prayer where you wrestle with God, and it's not a bad wrestling. It's where God is pushing you farther. Take it a little bit farther. Pray a little deeper. Get personal with God. By the way, I take you to the last few weeks. Guys, you're saved by a relationship, not keeping rules. And that relationship comes by you getting personal with God. And then be specific. Don't just pray for vague things. Get serious. And last, share the Father. Guys, what I mean by that is this. If you today were to receive bad news about your health, would you hope that your sisters and brothers in Christ would pray for you? Right. Okay. That's sharing the Father. In other words, when you pray for your knees and you pray for the things that are wrong in your life and you pray for the family members you're concerned about and you pray about, but there reaches a point where you're praying, Father, now what I'm asking for me, God, will you help them? Will you help that family? Will you help that marriage? God, will you help that kid? God, will you help that family that just lost a child to heroin? God, there's people out there that right now are thinking about quitting and giving up on their faith. Oh God, I share you with them. Isn't that what Jesus is doing for us right now? He is sharing the Father with us because He's interceding for us at the right hand of the Father. Brad's going to come up and he's going to sing a song You all know the song, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus." But before he starts singing, I want you all to stand. We're going to quote the Lord's Prayer together. Is that all right? And we're going to do the trespasses. No, I don't want you to trespass. But we're going to use trespasses. Let us pray this prayer because this is a lesson that Christ has taught us. Remember who He is. Offer your needs. Remember who you are and what can be. And after we're done praying, I'm going to open up the altar while Brad sings, okay? And let's just go ahead and do the Lord's Prayer right now. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. If you feel like you need to pray, you come on. Ask yourself. Working because I can see it. It's almost like looking at a crab doing the wave. I'm watching God work. And guys, those some who are already here, I don't know all their stories, but some, this is awesome. How's your prayer life? This might be just coming up here and saying, God, I'm committing myself to a better prayer life. Time in the Word, a better time, because my family's too important, and my church is too important, and my job is too important, and my co-workers is too important for me to do this. So where he's going to sing it, he's going to keep us saying, you come, would you? If that's something on your heart, you pray about it. Let's go.
I have decided to follow Jesus. Thank you.
give these folks a round of applause. Stepping out. Praise God. Amen. God, heal the hurts. Take us to another level. As a church, God, we already have intercessory prayer teams, and they've been praying all morning. And God, we have small groups, good small groups that pray. And God, we do pray, but Lord, deeper roots mean that we have to get serious with our prayer time. So God, teach us the lesson of a certain place where we can get away, just you and I, just you and us, and do a monstrous thing in our soul. Because God, there's a lot of lost people around us. There's a lot of broken families in our community. And God, our church is supposed to be a place of healing. Fill our altars, God, because of our prayer lives, God. Fill our altars with seekers. Fill the Sunday school classes with earnest learning. But make us all fervent praying people, we ask. We ask it in the name of Jesus, who is the only one who can make it possible. Would you say it with me? Amen. God bless you, folks. Have a marvelous day.
In this obsession with the things this world says make us happy.